Have you recently been told that your knee pain is due to meniscus tears, but want to do anything you can to avoid surgery?
Hey everyone, this is Dr. Zach Greenwood here, Performance Sport and Spine. In today's video, I'll be discussing meniscus tears. We'll go over the best rehab options and how some recent studies have shown that surgery is no better than exercise over the long term. So the meniscus is located in the knee, between the femur or thigh bone and the tibia or the larger bone in your lower leg. And there's actually two. The medial one, which is on the inside, and the lateral one, which is on the outside. These meniscus are made of fibrocartilage, and their purposes are to help dissipate the forces in the knee, provide shock absorption, and stabilize the knee. So there's two types of meniscus tears, traumatic and degenerative. So think traumatic, think young athlete and some sort of sports injury, and their knee may mechanically lock. This video is not designed for those kinds of tears. So the latter group, or the degenerative group, this process has probably happened over long periods of time, maybe even years, and there's no single event that happened. These exercises are designed for this group. And this includes people with or without radiographic findings, a sudden onset, or mechanical symptoms. We used to think mechanical symptoms were indicative of meniscus issues, but it turns out it's not specific to just that, and lots of knee issues can cause popping or snapping or locking of the knee. So we're going to give you some estimates for dosage and parameters for how long and much each stage should take. But it's always important to tailor it to the individual, so it's always better to go slow and give yourself plenty of rest time. And again, we always recommend working with a trained healthcare provider. So for the rehab program, we're going to start with restoring range of motion, strengthening the knee, addressing the whole kinetic chain, so think hip and ankle. Then we're working on proprioception and ballistic loading such as jumping. So the first thing is to restore range of motion of the knee. So for my left knee, we're going to try to work on that. So laying on your back with a slider on your heel, if you don't have this, you can just put a washcloth on a hardwood floor, and you're going to press your leg out to tolerance and then come back. And again, initially you might have limited range of motion, and that's fine. So we're just going to work through a range of motion, not stretch. Recommend 2-3 times a day, 10 reps. And again, the goal is to increase range of motion over time. Typically this takes 1 to 3 weeks. Some people may find the preferred position is in a seated position, as we demonstrate here. So now we'll go over two more advanced options for increasing range of motion. So the first is extension or straighten your knee. So place a light squishy ball behind your leg against the floor and maintaining heel contact with the floor. Press your knee down into the floor by engaging your quad or the anterior leg muscle. Slow and controlled, return, and then press down. Again, you may have to start with a partial range of motion and increase to tolerance. Do 1 to 2 times a day, 8 to 10 reps. So for bending the knee or knee flexion, we prefer the quadruped position. So starting on your hands and knees, you're gonna use your hands and push your hips back towards your ankles to tolerance, and then return to the starting position. Again, you may need to start with partial range of motion and increase over time. Again, 1 to 2 sets a day, 8 to 10 reps. And again, work towards the heels over time. You may need to put a washcloth or a cushion under your knee if it's too sensitive for direct pressure. Now we're going to go over some options for strengthening the knee in a non-weight-bearing fashion. But one thing we recommend is that you have full range of motion from the previous exercise before you start this, and minimal pain, between 1 and 2 out of 10. So the first exercise is going to strengthen the knee and the front muscle of your leg or your quad. So place a band around your ankles and sit on a bench. Bring the opposite heel back as far as you can. Using this front muscle, your quad, try to strengthen your leg. Now, maybe to pain or weakness, you can't go all the way. Partial range of motion is fine, but over time, work on increasing the range of motion. Recommend 2 sets of 10 to 12 reps, 3 to 5 times a week. An alternate to a band is an ankle weight, as I demonstrate here. And if you have neither, you can just kind of lift your leg up and down slow until you get equipment. So now for the hamstring or the muscle on the back of the leg. Again, in a seated position with the band around your ankles, bring the other leg as far forward as you can. And then pull the heel back towards your chair, feeling tension in the back of your leg. Straighten your leg slowly, and then pull back. Again, recommend 2 sets of 10 to 12 reps, 3 to 5 times a week. For the ankle weight position, we typically recommend standing with one arm supporting the chair, as we demonstrate here. And then the leg ball press. So place an exercise ball against a firm object in a seated position with your knee slightly bent. Again, contracting that quad or that front muscle, press your knee all the way straight or extended, and then return to the starting position. Again, do 2 sets of 10 to 12 reps,
3 to 4 times a week. To increase the difficulty, you can just scoot a little closer to the ball as you get stronger with time to make it more challenging. And again, try to make that full knee extension and you should feel tension over your anterior muscle. And then before progressing to the weight bearing exercises, we recommend that you do the non-weight bearing exercises for a minimum of 2 weeks. The glute bridge, laying on your back with your feet flat on the floor and your hands to your side, drive your hips up towards the ceiling with your glutes, pause, and return to the starting position. Recommend 1 to 2 sets of 10 reps, 3 times a week. With a box squat, with a box or a seat behind you, cross your arms or place them in front of you, squat down to tolerance, keeping weight on your midfoot, and stand up. You may need to adjust the height of the box or the step to your current tolerance, and you can increase weight over time as you feel confident. Recommend 2 sets of 10 reps, 3 times a week. And then from there, we recommend a reverse partial lunge, about halfway down, and come up. And then as that feels more comfortable, you can go deeper, or you can progress to the forward lunge. Recommend 2 sets of 8 reps, 3 times a week. Now, if you'd like, you can use your hand on a chair to help stabilize initially, and then remove it as you gain confidence. So now I'll give you 3 exercises for the kinetic chain, the hips, and the ankles. And recommend that you're confident and then the other exercises for 2 to 3 weeks before adding these in. So the first exercise is the calf raise. So holding on to something, raise your heels up as high as you can, slow and controlled, and then return to the starting position. Recommend 2 sets of 10 to 12 reps, 3 times a week. The next is a step up. Place your feet on a step or a chair, stand up, step down with the other leg, and alternate, step up with this leg, step up, and return. Same dosage as the previous exercise applies. Make sure to keep an upright torso and not lean forward too much. So the single leg deadlift. So if we're gonna have our stance leg as our left leg, we're gonna hold the weight in the opposite arm, and we're gonna press the opposite leg or the right leg backwards, letting our torso tilt forward, keep a weight on our midfoot, and then stand up. You should feel tension in your left glute and your hamstring as we do this. Slow and controlled. The same dosage applies as the previous exercise. This is somewhat challenging, so it may help to, again, hold on to that chair initially, and as you gain confidence and stability, remove as needed. And then balance and proprioception. And you can start this when you feel comfortable. So the first progression is just the inline balance, 2 to 3 sets of 30 seconds. If this is somewhat too challenging, you can go up on your toe or slightly stagger your stance, and then as you get more comfortable, progress to the next step. The second tier is just a single leg. And then the final tier will be doing it with your eyes closed. Find a spot, focus on it, and then close your eyes. And then ballistic exercises are jumping. And you should have no pain at this point, and then the other exercises for 8 weeks at least, and have confidence in all those movements. So the first one is just light hopping with 2 feet. Once or twice a week, 1 set of 10. From there, a little more intense, so hop a little higher, and then forward and back and side to side. Again, once or twice a week at most. After that, maybe 4th or 5th week, you can start with some single leg and then progress to forward, back, and side to side. So now we need to talk about 2 landmark papers. So this first one compared arthroscopic meniscus repair with exercise. And this is important because this is arguably the most common surgery performed worldwide. And what they found was that long-term follow-ups at 1 and 2 years, there was no difference between pain and function. Roughly $3 billion per year is spent on this surgery. And while this is important, is if surgery is no better than exercises, if you have the surgery, it takes 2 to 6 weeks to recover. You miss work between 1 and 2 weeks, and you're limited driving for 1 to 3 weeks. And then this paper compared true surgery with sham surgery, where the control group, the latter, the only difference between the two was that the meniscus was not removed. And again, they found no difference in long-term follow-ups at 1 to 2 years for pain and function. Further note, it's important to note that this is based off moderate to strong evidence, and future research is unlikely to change these recommendations. So again, for degenerative tears, surgery seems to be no better than just regular exercise over the long term. So now we'll talk about the 6 types of tears for the meniscus. One thing to note is that the mechanical knee symptoms are equally as common or present in people with or without meniscus tears. And then the longitudinal tears, or commonly called bucket handle tears, are strongly associated with with those acute knee traumas. So think young athlete and a high energy injury. So again, it's more than just, is your meniscus torn? It matters how old the person is. Was there a mechanism of injury to cause it? Or was this just some age-related changes that have happened over time? And then this increase in activity has caused the knee to be irritated. And then an image finds this quote unquote abnormality, and that's the causation.
So now we cover risk factors for degenerative meniscus tears. Now, one important thing to note is this is based off low quality evidence, so a big asterisk needs to be placed against this, as future research may change these. So being overweight, occupational activities such as frequent squatting, kneeling, or stairs, males, and then contact and pivoting sports. There's also conflicting evidence whether running and ACL reconstruction increases the chance for meniscus tears.
Thank you so much for watching our videos on meniscus tears. We hope you found it educational and helpful for dealing with the meniscus degenerative tears if you want to avoid surgery. If you did find the video beneficial, please like it and subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to watch our other videos.